if they're going to work. See, I turn the speaker off.
No.
Oh, Mr. Fleming, how you doing?
Pretty good.
I got you, and Mr. Hubbard, I got you.
All righty.
Gonna wait just a couple of minutes here. So how's everybody doing?
I'm doing all right.
You know that next week is midterm week, and midterm week is only 3 days long.
Oh, goodness.
Pardon me?
I did not know that.
Well, it's on the academic calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Our midterm is Tuesday, a week from today.
Oh, goodness. What's, are we having a written exam?
Well, it's in two parts. There's a part that'll be on Canvas, and I'll give you a sheet of paper to study from on Thursday. There's a part that's in Canvas, and then there's a score. And you can do that at home, but I won't open that score up. Till Tuesday, Tuesday morning. And I'll also, but just so you know, I'm going to give you the score on Thursday. So you won't know what the questions are, but you'll have a study guide, and the study guide will consist of not only questions on Canvas, but questions that might appear in the score part. Okay.
Sure.
And So that's really, I have to put it together. I mean, it's put together, but I have to put it together through Canvas, and I'll have that together for you on Thursday. All right? So we've been talking about Rondo form, and there's more or less just two types of Rondo form. There's the five-part Rondo, which goes theme, episode one, theme again, episode two, theme again. All right. And then there's the seven-part Rondo, which is theme, episode one, theme, episode two, theme, episode three, and then theme again. But sometimes that theme is a coda instead of the theme. Sometimes you get the theme and then a coda. So what I want to do is I'm going to find that little chart for you to make sure we understand that. Let's see. I got that, and I should have two windows. And I need to go to 33. So I'm going to share a screen with you right here. Okay, does everybody see this screen right here? It's from the book. This is page 133.
Yes, sir.
And here's what a five-part Rondo is. You have the principal theme, which is in the tonic key. That's really important because every time the reappearance of the theme, it's going to be in the tonic key. See, tonic key. All right. And then you're going to have in five part principal theme, episode one, it's going to be in the dominant or relative major usually, but maybe not, depending on how far we get, you know, into romantic period music, which is more expanded, because I want you to realize that it was Beethoven that expanded everything. Okay. So we talk about Mozart or we talk about Haydn, they're working in the form that they know, but it was Beethoven that expanded it, and the romantic composers picked that up and continued to expand. So we got principal theme, episode one, usually in the dominant or relative major. It'd be in the relative major if it was in minor, okay? Then we have the principal theme again. It's in the tonic, all right? And then we have episode two, and that could be just what episode one is varied, which is B prime, or it could be C. And usually in another related key. And the related keys are the keys that are within one accidental. So if we were in C major, it would be D minor. I'm walking up the C major triads. C major, no sharps or flats, D minor, one flat, E minor, one sharp, F, one flat, G, one sharp, and A minor, no sharps or flats, all right? So if you just walk straight up those, then you'll understand that. Carl, was that you I just saw a second ago?
It is. You just saw me enter.
All right. Carl, midterm week is next week. It's only 3 days long. Got it? Did
yes,
you hear
sir,
me,
I have
Carl?
It. Yes, sir, I have it.
All right. Our midterm is Tuesday.
Okay.
All right. I'll talk more about that at the end again. All right. And then we got the seven-part Rondo here. Principal theme is in the tonic key. Principal theme is in the tonic key. Principal theme is in the tonic key. Principal theme is always in the tonic key. I'm really stressing that because it's important when you try to recognize where the principal theme is. Because sometimes what we have is we have a transition back to the home key, and sometimes it uses the principal theme within that, okay? But that transition is an anticipatory transition. It's anticipating the main theme, all right? So I'm really just trying to stress that you'll find that in the tonic key, all right? So episode one would be in the dominant relative major, just like here, then the tonic key. And then just like here, it's in a related key, but usually you do have a C. You have something different than this. And then then you have the principal theme again. And then episode three would usually be either B prime, and it would be in the tonic key, or it would be D, something new. All right. Then you have principal theme and coda. And sometimes you don't have the principal theme, you just have the coda. And we saw that in the piece of music we looked at the other day. Any questions about that? Yes, no, maybe?
No.
All right. Good. So I'm going to share another screen with you. Share. All right, so you should see this rondo. It says four rondo. Does everybody see that?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, so this is in the book, and it's sideways in the book, so I had to flip all the pages around. It's four pages long, okay? So, again, I want to really stress that these double bars or repeat signs are often signs of this is a part, okay? This is something, all right? So this is definitely something right here, all right? It's even got a first ending and a second ending. Mm-hmm. Speaking of that, in first endings and second endings, you don't usually count in the measure numbers the second ending. Otherwise, things will be out of whack. Do you understand what I'm saying? So in other words, here we go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Then it repeats, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and it doesn't play that, it plays this. Mm-hmm. So if you were marking measure numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and this is kind of like 8 again, second ending. And then this is 9. Mm-hmm. And I want you to notice that this book gets out of whack. So this should really be 10. Okay. So one of the problems I want to really point out, and this is going to come up in your assignment here today, is that count the measures as opposed to you can use the measure numbers that are in here, but you need to count the measures to figure out if they're, you know, the same amount of measures or not, because it's kind of the way this happens. We don't usually count second endings, all right? So then we got this, and it rumbles on, and it rumbles on, and we clearly have something here, all right? See, there's an ending and a second ending, and it goes back all the way back up to the top. And then we have something here, all right? And that rumbles on through here. And it goes a long ways. And there's clearly something here, and it even says coda, okay? Now that doesn't mean that there's not more things in here, all right? Because this is rondo form, okay? And it's Mozart, but maybe some of the repeats are written out because they're varied. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So let's listen to this. This, by the way, is in your. There are only four audio files for this chapter, and this is one of them. So let me find the audio files. OneDrive. All right, here we go. I hope. Tell me if you can hear it.
Yeah, that's good.
Thank you. Repeat. This is the theme. I'm playing the wrong piece of music. All right. Here we go. They both say Mozart. Repeat. That's the theme. Here we go. That's the theme. They didn't play the repeat at the end. All right. Okay, so let's just kind of look at a few things here. And what I'm really trying to look for right now is the macro structure as opposed to the smaller structure. So yeah, I am interested in phrases and periods and things like that. Okay. But I'm also interested in what the structure is in overall, the form. So it's kind of a large form. So,
part rondo.
Pardon me, sir?
This is seven part rondo.
Well, that's what we're going to figure out. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to disagree with you yet. Okay? Because I don't actually know. All right? Although I know the piece of music, I've never actually, at least I don't think I have, not in recent times, figured it out, all right? But we know that this is the principal theme right here, okay? So I am drawing on a piece of paper, okay? And if you give me a second, I'm going to log in with my telephone so I can kind of show you sometimes what it is. Form analysis, click. All right, so in theory I'm here. Don't know where I am though. Yeah, I'm right there. It's got my name twice now. All right. So just ignore that, and I'll bring that window forward when it's time. All right. So I'm making a graph. Okay. And I'm not dividing this up into parts or anything like that, but I'm making a graph that really says, and remember, I'm going to use these measure numbers. Otherwise, we're going to get confused. See, normally what I do is I write the measure number on each measure so I never get confused. Each measure of the whole thing. So if I want to go to a certain measure, I know right where it's at. You see that in band scores all the time. On the bottom, they'll have the measure number, every measure number on the whole score. All right, but I basically have 8 measures, okay? And that's the principal theme. Does everybody agree with me right here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I'm going to call this 1. This is 11, so this is 10, so this is 9. Unfortunately, it's 1 through 9, but it's really 1 through 8. It's the principal theme. All right. And then I have the next thing here. And it went on and on and on. And I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to start it over and I'm going to pause it when we hear the principal theme again. Okay? Is that good? Are we all good
yes.
with that? All right.
Yes.
Here we go. There it is right there. All right. See, it is right here. That's the pickup or the anacrusis, and here's the theme. So what key is it in? First of all, what key are we in the beginning? We're in G major. Everybody see
it?
There's
one flat, right? You can't see. It's kind of small.
All right. Yeah, and I'm not going to disagree that it's kind of small. And especially if you're looking on your phone, it's really small. Can you see it better now? Yes, no, maybe? Can you see it better?
Yeah, I can see it. It's G major?
Yeah, it's in G major. It starts with a G. The first cadence is a half cadence. The second cadence is a authentic cadence, actually a perfect authentic cadence, just so you know. So it went through, it made a half cadence, went through again, made another cadence. And there's probably another cadence in between here. I'm not going to worry about that because that's not what we're doing today. All right. But 1 through 8. And then we went on and looked, and here it is. See it right there?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So what key do we think we're in?
We done changed to the, we done went to the dominant key.
Which You're is, right. We went to the dominant
five.
Key. Are we still in the dominant key?
Yes.
All right. So, if we're still in the dominant key, see, we got C sharp here?
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So, this is probably some sort of anticipatory type of thing. All right. And I'm going to just play it for a little while here, but I'm looking for where the theme comes back in. You see this right here? Do you see this right here?
Yes.
See, what happens is, I'm gonna circle this on the score so we know what it is. Okay, please let me type. There we go. And I'm just gonna circle this. So we can always get back to it. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we're probably about right here. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to start up the audio. And every time the principal theme comes back in, I'm going to pause it and we're going to just kind of circle it for a moment. Because this isn't simple to do. This isn't anything that I would expect you to be able to do on a midterm. So don't sweat this, all right? But it's important to be able to look at the larger part and figure out what it is. All right, let's see. Have to go back to this. And here we go. I'm going to back it up just a little bit so we'll be on the theme or coming up to the theme. Here we go. Here it is. A little bit different. That's thematic, but it's not the theme. We're back here. I'm going to pause this for a minute. I actually think this recording doesn't take any of the repeats. See, because you see how we got to here and it went, it did this.
Da-da-da-da.
Yeah. So it's not taking any of the repeats. So let's start it from the beginning again. And I'm going to start drawing lines. And you understood why I drew that line here? Because it was something new. Do you understand what I'm saying? So I'm going through the score, drawing lines, and I'm going to base it on we're probably not repeating anything, except I think we repeated the opening phrase from the beginning. I'm stopping it because I don't know where it went back to. So, because it definitely went back. It went back to here. This has been my problem the whole time. You see this? It didn't go back here. It went back to here. All right? It looks like it, but it doesn't sound like it. So this is driving me crazy, all right? So I'm going to stop actually doing recordings at the moment, listen to it, and I'm going to draw some more lines where I know they are. And I'm doing this just by looking at the music, all right? You see, this is some sort of theme right here. Da-da-da-da-da-da. And it's kind of like an intro to the theme, sort of. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Thematic material.
Yes, we see it.
All right. So I'm just kind of looking through the score here. See it right here? Everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
There it is again.
Yes.
So that's the theme again. Let me circle that. Okay, so I know that's a theme. And I also don't see any accidentals. You see how I don't see any accidentals in it? In this thematic area?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's probably in the tonic key. And we're going to go back and investigate that in a minute, all right? This is all thematic-like, too, but it actually doesn't seem to be the theme. Because it just stops. That's not the same pitch, but and Carl can sing it way better than I can. And this is just kind of the thematic material leading to the coda. All right. And I'm gonna draw this here. All right. So now if we go back. All right. I'm just gonna say the theme is right here. We all agree that the theme is in the beginning. And if I have this theme, the problem is this is in major. See it, right? I mean, it's in the dominant key, right? So I think this is anticipating something, all right? And I'm just kind of looking, and I think it continues on, all right? And I think that this is in a different key too. What key do we think this is in? Look at all these flats.
May have changed to the minor.
Carl. Was that Carl?
Was Carl.
I think that's a pretty good thing, right, at least right here. But then we start getting A flat. Excuse me, that's B flat. Wrong clef. Sorry. All right. Let's just say we went to the minor key, the relative minor. All right. It's not the relative. It's the The word's escaping. The parallel minor. Does everybody understand? It's the parallel minor. G is G, and you have modes. The major is Ionian. The minor is Aeolian. All right. So, yeah, maybe we change to the parallel minor. And let's see where we get back on track. See, he's got these natural signs going along. So somewhere he had an F sharp to make the dominant key pop, probably, because there's an F natural right there. He does drop an E flat there. And this is pretty neat. Here we go. This is thematic material. Let's just say it is. What key do we think this is in?
when it went to back to the dominant, which is the key of D, maybe. Because I see a D natural.
Yeah, okay, Carl.
That's what I was looking at.
And it's hard to do this, but look at this. See that right there? This is the beginning in G, right. And D. Does everybody?
It's in G now, right?
Yeah.
But then I looked at it because it's like it went to now. It's probably brought an accidental. It put like accidentals in the music because I was looking at that right there.
Yeah, but the natural sign here is just saying that I no longer have, and let me rate. I have just as much trouble seeing it as you. I no longer have a B flat because I had a B flat right here, and I had a B flat right here, probably. No, that's actually an E flat. But anyways, you understand what I'm saying. But this is in, if you look at this, this is in G. All right. See that right there? See the bass line?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right. So I definitely got the principal theme here. All right. And the principal theme goes, and then it's modified. All right. And then it goes to the coda. All right. So maybe there's something else that we're missing here. All right. And so I'm just kind of looking at this whole thing as something a little bit larger. Does everybody understand what I'm kind of doing here?
Yeah.
All right. So we clearly kind of modulated to the dominant. I don't really think it's any larger than this. Okay. But all I'm saying is that let's just say this is a two phrase period, and then this is a some other phrase period that then returns right here in its three part form. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That the theme is kind of like three part form. I don't think it is. Okay, but these are all the variables you can look. This is far more complicated than I ever thought it would be, actually. But so I got a principal theme in measure one. I'm writing this down on a piece of paper. I got some sort of principal theme in measure 33. All right. And I'm using their numbers. All right. I got some sort of principal theme in 58, 59, 58. Does everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. I got a principal theme in 98. Okay. Because I'm trying to sit here and figure this out. All right. I just kind of looked on the next page to see what was going on. That's why I keep scrolling up and down. Of course, this is in your course packet. And I have just repetition of the principal theme, repetition of the principal theme, at least the principal theme's motive all over the place here. And that's really leading to the coda, okay? So and I'm going to call the coda the last part, okay? So in theory, and we're going to have to go back and look at it, I only got five parts. I have measure one, where we have theme. Measure one, right here, first part, mm-hmm. All right? All right. Then after that, I have something else.
An episode.
I'm sorry, let me rephrase this. I have one, two, three, four entrances of the principal theme, all right? So maybe I got seven part. I don't think so. And the reason I don't think so is we already established that this was not in the tonic key, right?
Right.
All right. But if you look at it right here, it is. It's a different note. It's varied. It's a different note. See right here, it starts out in the dominant key, like Carl and everybody agrees. And it maybe went to that. And it clearly cadences in on what? A. Cadences on A. All right? Mm-hmm. So that's the half cadence in the dominant key, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the dominant key is D, and that's a half cadence in the dominant key. All right?
Yes, sir.
This is scale degree 4. This is scale degree 5. All right, just so you know, and this was 1 right before that. So my measure 33 is still part of the episode.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem like it actually went back. All right. So then I'm continuing on here, and here I got theme, and it's way out there. It's in a different key, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
No, it's in Z minor.
It's in G minor.
G minor, my bad.
Yeah. All right. I'm writing this down on this piece of paper. All right. So G minor. Okay, now I hate to tell you this, but G is G is G. No matter what mode you're in, it's G. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that means I got a return of the principal theme, except it's been varied. It's in minor. Does everybody understand that? So that makes part 3. So I'm writing on this piece of paper, episode 1. And episode 1 starts in measure 10. And it goes to measure 57. Okay, and it's principally in the dominant key. I'm going to share a different screen now. Let's see. I don't know how I can do this. All right, for a second here, I'm pinning this video here. And I don't know if you can see this. And I'm having trouble getting it in the right place. But basically, I've now written something that's a tonic. It's the principal theme. It's measures 1 through 8, but it's really 1 through 9 measure number wise. Then I have episode 1 that goes from measure 10 to measure 57, and it's in the dominant key. So now I'm going to do this, and I'm going to write it's in G minor. Sorry, and it's hard to do this one-handed, but it's in G minor. I'm going to write it like this. All right, and it starts in measure 58. So I'm working on a large-scale graph. Does everybody kind of understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm going to get rid of this share, and I'm going to go back to, and you were able to see that, right?
Yeah, I just scrolled over.
All right. So I'm going back here, and I'm going to screen share where we were looking at, Ina Kleina Nacht music. This is the 4th movement of the Ina Kleina Nacht music, which we looked at the 3rd movement. And the 1st movement goes dum bum 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 pa dum bum bum. So you've probably heard that a million places. All right, so here we go. It's in G minor. All right. So this is the return of the principal theme. All right. So after the principal theme goes away, which is probably somewhere around here. All right. It doesn't look like it goes very long. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start playing this again, and I'm going to stop where it's at. I wish I had a giant screen, but all I have is a laptop. Well, I'm going to start it about in the middle somewhere. Thank you. beginning. Sorry. Okay, here comes that theme, but it's not. It's still the dominant key. So we're probably in some sort of Latin transition. Some people might call it a theme. Back at the beginning. And here we are in the dominant key. Here we should be in G minor, right here. Right here. All right. It's right here. I'm drawing a line. All right. So that's probably where it ends, and it's only like eight measures, probably. One. This right here is kind of the introduction to that, sort of. But it's one, two, or one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I guess it's 9, 10, unless I got it in the wrong spot. I'm just going to back up the recording for a little bit and go back to listening to it. Sure, put it in the wrong place. Right there. We have basically... I somehow, what drives me crazy is I'm at some place and it decides to go to a different page. All right, here's our G minor one, and here it is right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, it's more or less eight measures, okay? It actually probably terminates here, but it's in G minor. Does everybody sort of agree? Yes, no, maybe? Or are you lost?
I mean, I see how, well, I don't know why it's G minor. I'm only seeing E G. I'm saying
E flat.
E flat, B flat, and like, A flat was there's three flats, right?
So here we go, and this it starts out in this key. Here's
B flat.
I got G B. E flat G B flat. Mm-hmm. Carl, what do you think? Carl, I'm listening to you, buddy. So I think it's probably an E flat. Does everybody agree? Maybe.
Yes. Well, do we have A?
Here's B flat.
Say it again, Doc.
So remember how we thought this was maybe in G minor?
That's right.
Yeah. Can you hear me? Can you hear me, Carl?
One more time. My connection went bad.
Can you hear me?
Now I can.
Okay. We thought this was in G minor, but Mr. Hubbard is pointing out the obvious that we never looked at. We actually never looked at the bass line. Okay. We go back up to the very beginning. The bass line is clearly going to tell us where we're at. All right.
True.
All right. Here it is right here. E flat, B flat, E flat. Same tonic dominant notes that it had in the beginning. So let's say we're in E flat. So what's E flat? Okay.
E flat is
the foreign key.
Yeah, it's the foreign key. Very foreign key.
Relative minor.
E flat's a major key, right?
I'm sorry, not E flat.
Well,
I thought E flat major was B, E, and A flat.
B flat, E flat, and A flat. Yeah. So are you saying you don't see A flats?
Oh, sorry. Yep. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I do. I'm sororry.
Yeah, there is a B flat right there. All right.
Oh, that's another B flat.
Yeah. No, this is the treble clef right here. This is the alto clef. Mm-hmm. See, it's A flat.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna minus this one now. Here it is. 1-5-1. It does the same thing it did before in the beginning. So let's just say it's an E flat.
E flat major.
E flat major. So that throws out my whole theory, but that's okay. This is what it takes sometime, and probably because I'm not going to go on with this forever, I will pick it up on Thursday because I want to talk about some other things. But it's an E flat, so that throws out everything. So if I don't know what it is, then I got to do some research, maybe find some help, or maybe figure it out myself. All right. Which could take some time, more than just this little class period, because I'm, because you know it's really hard to do it like this, as opposed to a piece of paper. But anyways, that's no excuse. So we're in E flat here, and it changes right here. But you know it kind of does the same. See this pattern right here. See this right here in the beginning? This is that right here again. See it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's cruising along. It's cruising along. And I'm going back up here to make some more comparisons. And this is where it's all difficult. See this right here?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let me show it to you. This is why you really need pieces of paper. This is called two-finger analysis, which I would have shown you. All right, so let me just say, I'm looking for this little lick right here. Bunch of notes, and then this little lick going down here. All right? There it is right here. Now I'm going up here, and I'm looking at it. It's more or less the same thing. Does everybody see this right here? And this right here, all right? But the difference is, and there is a difference, is it's in a whole bunch of voices here. All right. Where am I? But here it's only in the upper voice. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
And it's extended. All right. And it falls here. And this is principal theme material too, which we were, oh, I'm sorry. We're already talking about that. I'm just kind of looking at the music here, and this is what you have to do. We already know this is, and we already know that this is in the tonic key, all right? C, G, D, G?
Mm-hmm.
All right. It's in the tonic key. I don't think it's in the minor key because I don't see any accidentals. And that leads directly to the coda, all right? So... /98, /99, /100, /101. I'm actually counting these measures out here. I'm gonna have to count them actually later to 130. All right. Because what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make a comparison. This is what I'm gonna do, you know, after class or tomorrow. I'm gonna make a comparison of this principal theme in the same key to the first one and see what the difference are and see if I'm missing anything in this. I clearly know this is the principal theme, but does it extend on as we talked about before? The only problem is here, it seems to be, this is an A, do you see it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it seems to be in another key here. So I'm just curious what happens in the back. All right. So I just want to finish this up a little bit on Thursday and tell you what I've discovered, okay?
All right.
I'm going back to another share, all right? Not the desktop. But... All right, so let's see. Do you see the modules now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm trying to figure out how to get rid of this. All right, so we have modules, and I have an assignment here, all right? Much simpler than the one we just looked at, okay? I actually made sure it was relatively simple. The assignment is, and you already know this piece of music if you did the assignments, because this was one of the first assignments, okay? And the first assignment did not tell you to analyze the first eight measures. It told you to analyze some measures further down the line. All right. Most likely the first eight measures are exactly the same as what in theory you already analyzed. So but all I want you to do here in this case is locate on the score and identify the cadences. So you locate the cadence, you tell me what key it's in and what kind of cadence it is. All right. You're only going to do the first eight measures and then indicate where the period or periods are. And if there are two phrases, three phrases, four phrases, and if there are symmetrical or asymmetrical, well, it's going to be pretty obvious. They're probably two phrases because there's only eight measures. And so when I look at here, you're only going to the repeat signs. It is the first eight measures. Listen, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But unfortunately, this is measure 4 right here, not 5. Do you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So they're counting this as measure 1. It screws it all up. But again, just understand that this is an eight measure phrase. So be careful about that when you're counting, all right? And just use the measure numbers they are. In other words, this is measure number 1. which is the pickup. So this is measure number two, and that's the measure we count. It'd be 2 through 4, 5, 6. That doesn't make sense. This is measure 5, not 4. You understand what I'm saying? So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But it's all screwed up. So I want you to just use the measure numbers that are there, all right? But in this first part, you need to count the measure numbers to figure out if they're symmetrical or asymmetrical, so on and so forth, all right? So this is Mozart's ding, 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 ding. And it's only 2 pages long. It's in rondo form, okay? This is it. Of course, all of these are in your anthology. I'm just pulling them out. But sometimes it's easier than stumbling through that giant PDF or if you have the book. But let's just take a listen to this. So give me a second here. Here we go. So part two, listen to the work. It's rondo form and indicating the score, where the principal themes are, and where the episodes are. Okay, I got to back up to part one, all right? In part one, after you've figured out what that is, I want you to go page 71. Do that, please. Description of a period. And follow that along. And every time there's an italicized word in that little description of a period, that's the word you change. All right, and I want you to write a short paragraph, which is really just a description of the first. It says 16 measures. That's a mistake. I'll change that. It should be 8 measures. All right. All right. Write a short paragraph about the first 8 measures based on the given example in page 71. Okay. So in part two, then you're gonna do the whole thing. All right, and then it says, just write a short paragraph, include the page numbers, including page numbers. It should say of the form, and I'm sorry, I screwed that up again. So I really want you to just kind of make a graph yourself of the big areas. And the other thing, and I'm going to have to add this to it, and I'm really sorry I didn't put it all in there. I want you to indicate the key areas that things are in, okay? So, principal theme, probably in the tonic. Episode one, probably in the dominant or relative minor, whatever it is. But I want you to notice that I said this is in this key right here, right? I made it bold, so don't screw it up, okay? I've had lots of people analyze this in A minor and nothing makes any sense, all right? So I'm gonna change this ratio parameter, include the measure numbers of the form and the key area. So you're going to like write, you know, Mozart's Panio Sonata number 16 in C major K545 is in rondo form, period. And then you're going to say the first theme begins in measure such and such and ends in set measure such and such. And I'm not interested whether it's a period or anything at this point. I just want you to make a big one. And it's in the tonic key, all right? The first episode begins here. It's in this key and ends here, you know, begins here and ends here, and it's in this key. And so on and so forth. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
All right. So this is Mozart. It's a piano sonata. It's pretty simple to figure out, all right? We listen to the whole thing. It's not really long. It's not nearly as complicated as Ina Klein and Nacht music. All right? So that's that right there. All right? So I'm getting rid of the stare, and then I want everybody to understand that next week on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday is midterm week. It only is 3 days long. So our midterm is on Tuesday. On Thursday, I will give you a sheet of paper that says, here are the things you got to know. So on Tuesday, and it's divided into two parts. And one part will be on Canvas. It'll be probably some terms and stuff like that we've discussed. And, or maybe some silly questions like I might say, how many parts is, rondo is in, it comes in two forms, and they are. And you might write 5-part form and 7-part form or something like that. That would really be the only rondo type of thing I would do. I would not make you look at rondo on the exam. All right. I will also give you a score on Thursday that you look over along with a list of things that you need to understand or look over. So the list of things, not all of the things are in the score, but they might be terms that's in the Canvas part, all right? But most, not all of them are play a role in either that or the score I'm going to give you, all right? The score I'm going to give you, I'll ask you questions, and one of those questions is going to be to go, and I'll give you the statement, to go to that page 71, description of a paragraph, and tell me what this is right here. I will even analyze the cadences for you. At least I'll draw the Roman numerals and tell you what key they're in. I'm not going to tell you what kind of cadence they are. All right?
Yeah.
But you need to really take it seriously. Okay?
Yes, so sir.
You should check. I'm just kind of warning everybody who's here that midterm is next week. And it's only 3 days long.
It's crazy.
Well, this is this kind of compressed thing there. And so you need to check in with all your classes like this week and make sure you know what's going on in the midterm exam. All right. And what they're doing. So don't give up on the semester at all. I'm encouraging everybody to just keep up with your classes. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Remember, we're going to finish by Thanksgiving.
Woo
woo. Woo woo. All right. Anyone have any questions?
No, sir.
Okay. Your composition stage 2 is also due on Thursday also, just so you know. All right. Now, just listen to me. You can't do stage 2 until you complete stage 1, and I say go on to stage 2, and I give you a little grade in the little part where it says grades for stage 1, which is worth only 10 points. All right, so be aware of that.
All right.
And if anyone turned anything in, I will be looking at it momentarily. All right.
Yes. That's our money in life.
Hey, everybody.
All righty.
All right. Bye-bye.